Well, thank you very much, everyone, for having us. My name's Kate Stewart, and I'm a director at the Lewis Foundation, which is a nonprofit that acts as a home for various open source projects, and acts as a, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that afterwards if you're interested, but one of the projects that I'm working on with Marina and others is Zephyr, and with that, let Marina introduce herself.
Hi, my name is Maureen Helm. I'm a software engineer at NXP, and one of the maintainers on the Zephyr project, so I've been working on that for about the past year, so pretty excited to be here to talk to you today about it. I want to let you guys know there's going to be a little quiz at the end here. I have a couple of boards to give away, so pay attention. We've got three or four NXP Kinetis boards here that we're going to give away, so.
Thanks. So, how many people here have heard of Zephyr before tonight? A couple hands, but lots of newbies. Okay, so Zephyr basically is a very small footprint RTOS. And you say, okay, what's the Linux Foundation doing with another OS? Why not just Linux? Well, there's places where Linux won't fit. And so what we wanted to do was try to see if we could get the same dynamic that worked at Linux, an open community, working for the small MCU form factors. So Zephyr is a very small footprint, can be as small as about 8K. It enables your application code to scale, so you're just basically compiling together what you need. You don't have a huge lot of overhead in selecting it. It's using the same config mechanisms that Linux does, and the same build infrastructure type of thing. So it's very modular, very configurable. And Marie can give you more detail about that than I certainly can, because she's in the day-to-day. It is actually truly open source. The Foundation's hosting it the same way we host Linux and all of other projects. We're very much committed to transparent development. Everything is happening on the mail list, and the commits are all public, as are the minutes from the discussions. It's Apache 2 licensed, so it's easier in some ways for working into some of the nuanced projects. It's a permissive license. And at this point now, well, we started a year ago, we had three architectures when we launched, and we're now up to six architectures supported in the project natively. We've got ARM, x86, ARM, and there's multiple flavors of the ARM core that are supported right now. They're ARM M cores, M0, M4, M3 are there. And in the last 6 months, we've added RISC-V, or actually, we haven't added, well, the community's actually added RISC-V, it's 10 silicon, and then IOS-2. So we are making certain good Zephyr products, but that's what Zephyr is right now. And then, obviously, the question is, why yet another RTOS? What was being found is everyone had a bunch of RTOSes out there, and everyone seemed to have limited problems, and there was nothing everyone could rally around. And so this fragmentation was causing a lot of NRE and a lot of proprietary sort of niche players. And we really didn't have any way we could actually work on pulling together a true ecosystem for, because it's only whatever, most of the other RTOSes out there have like one company associated with them. They wanted to have something that would be multiple company and neutral, like Linux is. So these things started motivating some discussions. Intel was in there right at the start, and they took the Minerva's code base from a project from Minerva, and they reworked it, and then that is what they looked at using as a starting point, and they made sure it was a multi-architecture one to start off with. Part of the reason for doing this sort of thing is so we could all start to collaborate on the security of this. We could actually design something from the start with the security needs in mind, so that as this project matures, we'll be adding certifications and other things to it. However, it's about a year in, and it seems to be making some decent progress, but it does, work from that perspective. That's why we were trying to do it. And NXP joined us right as a founding member, as did Synopsys. Synopsys obviously cares about some of the security, as does NXP, and some of the libraries and things from Intel. So everyone sort of had these two main focuses in mind, modularity, and then getting something to collaborate on for security. So right now we've got Lenaro, who's joined us as a Platinum member, NXP, Intel, and Synopsys. And we've got Runtime IO and Nordic joined us recently for the Silver members too. If anyone wants to talk about membership, that's fine, but realistically, the Zephyr project I'm telling you about, it's an open project. You don't need to be a member to contribute or participate. And here's the architectures, which I was sort of talking about earlier. We've got the Tensilica and IOS RISC-V that got added. And then those top ones are the ones we started with. So this is some of the metrics we're starting to look at for the project. We launched in February 17th, 2016. And before that, you'll pretty much see all the contributions into the code base. That's part of the cleanup from when we were in Intel. After that, you now start to see we're getting a wider community starting to participate. So that was one of our goals for this project, is to actually build a multi-community, not one single company dominating. And we're moving towards that. We've designed the governance and things like that for it. So over the last year, we've gone from 5 repositories to 10, 80 authors to 270 unique authors. We started at that launch date with having 5,800 commits, and we're now at 14,000 into the code base. And this is people adding code, deleting code, reworking code, trying to get something that they all can believe and use effectively in products. And we've gotten 4 boards at launch, 57 now in the code base. And Marie just did that survey earlier today and did some grepping in the source just to see how many we actually have. And then in the last month, what we've done is gone from using a Garrett-based system, and we've listened to the developers out there, and we've moved over to GitHub. So we're using, there's a public GitHub instance, and we're moving more of the infrastructure over into GitHub to make it easier for people to work with and contribute. So there's just a sample, about 32 of the boards. But like I said, we've got 57 different ones in there now. And I encourage you to obviously look at the code. Now, part of what the Linux Foundation does is set up governance for these projects so that people have ways of collaborating together. And from Linux's example, what we've taken is we have to keep the business decisions away from the technical. So our members that you saw in that slash sheet earlier are part of the governing board and participate in the governance side. Anyone in the community can participate in the project and actually make their way onto the technical steering committee through their contributions. So you don't have to be a member to participate, and you can get into the leadership positions in the project. What the governing board does is it sets the goals and then decides how the funds get allocated for supporting the infrastructure. And then, you know, the technical steering committee basically coordinates the cross-community collaborations and sets up new projects and approves basically the voting members on it, approve when new release, and that sort of thing. But as I say, the code base is open to all contributors. And this is, you know, we started this project off with a very strong focus on security and are trying to, as we build up the technologies, build into security with it. We have libraries that have been tested, fairly robust, and we're working on making sure we have reasonably good coding practices, actually excellent coding practices, and refining our ability to pull things in so that we can go after certifications next year. And in order to go after certifications, what we're going to need to do is have an auditable code base. And there's a lot of overhead associated with it, and that's why we have to be sort of thinking about it right from the start as things come in. Because a lot of the problems that are out there right now are people taking code bases and afterthoughts and paying lots of money to go and get them into a state where they can take to products that can be certified. And what we want to try to do is look at it from making sure we can build the right pieces into it so the process isn't too onerous on the other side. So what we're going to be doing right now is, development. And the GitHub tree is used development. We'll be cutting a long-term support stable type of branch, if you're familiar with the Linux technology. This will be sort of what we'll be holding on to for a long period of time as development will continue to move on with new boards, new technologies, and so forth. But we want to keep a base stable. And that stable base, once we cut that, that's when we'll start getting planning for the auditable going.
Kate, how many boards did you say?
We're at 57 right now.
Right.
And so it's all configurable, so it's a question of what we're going to actually certify what's auditable, and that's how I'm applying it to. And that's going to be governing board decisions as to what we're going after for the auditable, and the artifacts are what the members will get. But the code base will always be open for everyone, across all these. Yeah.
Do you envision this code base to be just a number of packages that are compiled, or is it going to be one?
Well, actually, thank you. Zephyr is actually an ecosystem. We're sitting outside of community. We've actually got a bootloader we've also agreed to work on with others that we're working on, it, and that's part of the community. There's various third-party modules and libraries, and then there's, you know, JavaScript, Python, and so forth. That's probably more the big picture community. The actual project itself, it's sort of what's under the Zephyr repositories. Well, we've got the RTOS itself, obviously, as well as the SDK, and some of the drivers and middleware. So we're sort of segmenting it that way. And then Zephyr itself is a kernel, and they have our abstractions and various services. And with that, I will probably turn it over to Maureen to give you more details on that.
So just to touch a little bit more on the question about, you know, packages, Zephyr, by and large, is all part of one repository. It's a single application that's compiled with the kernel itself, so it's a lot different than Linux or other larger operating systems that you might see on a, you know, multi or on a larger core kind of device. You know, in this case, we're talking about much, much smaller devices, Cortex-Ms, you know, single digits of kilobytes of flash potentially. So, you know, we're generally not looking at dynamic modules to begin with. You know, we may scale that way in the future, but at least right now, it's one single module.
What about the tools and the debugging and all that kind of stuff?
So it varies a bit across platforms because we are supporting both, you know, not both, but Cortex-Ms, x86, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And so we do have a variety of tools that are supported, so depending on what device you're using. But that's where the Zephyr SDK comes into play, where we consolidate all those tools into a single package. And so you can just get all your tool chains, you know, you get an x86 tool chain, you get a Cortex-M tool chain, et cetera. Yeah.
Does it currently support Cortex-A7?
A7?
Yeah.
No, right now we're restricted down to Cortex-M. I potentially in the future, you know, if somebody's interested in porting to an A4, that's certainly a possibility, but at this time we're down in the Cortex-Ms.
So you have the cryptography services listed there.
Yeah.
A large package.
So we imported embed-TLS into the tree as is. So that's actually something that, in general, we're trying to reuse things where we can. So embed-TLS is a really good example of that. I'm trying to think of what else. We're using SIMSIS, if you guys are familiar with that. Some of the vendor SDKs, so peripheral drivers and things like that.
Looks like the IO APIs are probably standardized.
Yeah, that's actually what I'm going to cover next. So, did somebody have another question?
Does it run on a Raspberry Pi?
Not yet.
Okay.
Ports are welcome.
What?
Ports are welcome.
Yeah, I think it's free time. Insert patches here.
Exactly. Absolutely. Yeah, we are always eager to get patches from the community, so we can't emphasize that enough. But, new contributors are welcome. Yeah.
General question about from an embedded developer perspective. Is the Zephyr acting like an OS cradling the application, or is this something when you build it, you're just linking all the components together and using Zephyr at startup to start that? You understand what I mean by the difference there? I'm not sure I understand.
Okay, well, let me get into some of the architecture, and maybe that will answer your question, then
okay.
We can come back to it if I don't answer it. Does that work?
That sounds great.
All right, cool. So like Kate said, Zephyr is designed to be highly configured and highly modular. For those of you that are familiar with Linux, we make use of kconfigs and kbuilds at this point to configure pieces of the kernel, the device drivers, some of the higher level stacks, and to configure all that using kconfig as well as at compiler time. Like I mentioned earlier, there's not a whole lot of runtime configurability because we are trying to be very mindful of the size of the code that we are building in, because these devices tend to be quite small. And so, you know, we're constantly looking back at that, you know, can we still fit the kernel into an 8K kind of device? Obviously, you know, when you start talking about higher level stacks and things like that, you're not going to get an 8K device. You know, you need TCP/IP or Bluetooth, that kind of thing. But there are certainly applications that we're targeting, so we can continue to keep that in mind. So the kernel itself features two types of threading. There's a cooperatively scheduled thread and preemptively scheduled threads. If anybody has prior experience with Zephyr or seen it before, these have been known as a nano kernel and a microkernel kind of module, for those of you that have seen it before. Memory resources are typically statically allocated, so we're not talking about mallocs and dynamic allocation for the most part. And again, cross-architecture, so x86, multiple ARM architectures, ARP, ES2, RISC-V, Extensa, and anything else you guys can come up with. So kind of breaking down the block diagram here of what the architecture looks like. So at the very bottom, you see some of the hardware type of enablement. So, you know, we're talking about radios, sensors, things like accelerometers and gyroscopes, cryptography hardware abstractions, flash abstractions, and then you'll start to see some of the OS level services and the level APIs. I apologize, this looks a little bit grainy on the screen here, but the one thing that's really important to think about Zephyr is that we have a HAL-like abstraction for things like SPIs and UARTs and I2Cs and things like that, and so you're not left with, you know, if you're trying to cross SoCs from one vendor to another, these all have common APIs in this architecture. So I think that simplifies things as you move up the stack and you start talking about application levels, you know, higher level device APIs like sensory drivers and things like that that need to talk to an I2C. Makes it a lot easier to write a sensor driver if you only have one interface you gotta talk to. Let's see. So moving up the stack a little bit, so we don't just stop at threading and low-level services like that, and device drivers. We are targeting to include stacks, so a TCP/IP networking stack, which features a dual-mode IPv6 IPv4 stack, Bluetooth low energy, and then some of the beginnings of IoT protocol layers like MQTT and CoAP.
Those BLE stack, IP stack, are they ported from some other open source project?
Good question. So when we started, we did actually use an IP stack borrowed from the Contiki. RTOS, as we grew, that became less and less, we kind of struggled with it. Lots of band-aids on top of band-aids. And so ultimately, we made the decision to go and move to a natively developed stack. So Intel has been investing a lot of resources in developing this stack natively for Zephyr. So it's very well tuned to what we're trying to do in Zephyr. And the Bluetooth stack, to answer the second half of that question, that is native to Zephyr as well. So that's not borrowed from somewhere else.
And the memory resources are statically allocated. Does that mean that those C library and malloc, those are not supported in the application layer?
So I haven't seen a lot of that. We do support other C libraries, but like I said, it's predominantly statically allocated, but I don't think that would preclude one from doing that. Anything else? Okay, so I thought I'd talk a little bit more about some of the features that we've been working on over the past year. Since this is a pretty young project, you know, we can talk about each of these releases that we've been working on. We're on a quarterly release cycle. We're in the process of putting together our 1.8 release, so that's where we are today. We just closed our merge window a week ago, so we're working on stabilizing that release now. But going back to roughly about the 1.6 timeframe, which is what we released at the end of last year, couple of important features that we incorporated in that, one of which was the unified kernel. We had this legacy nano kernel, micro kernel kind of architecture that a lot of our users found kind of confusing. And so we decided to streamline that, and so we have now a, what we call a unified kernel, which is a lot easier to use from a device driver standpoint, from a middleware kind of standpoint. A couple of the other features that we pulled in 1.6, Nordic actually contributed a BLE controller, open source controller, as part of Zephyr. Let's see, we saw some native CoAP stack coming in, and some initial USB device support, so we have mass storage device support, and some early power management kinds of features that went in at 1.6. So going on to 1.7, that was where the our new IP stack landed. So that we transitioned from 1.6 to 1.7, we pulled in this new stack from Intel. This stack, like I said before, is designed for IoT in mind, so dual IPv4, IPv6. That was something that we kind of struggled looking at some of the other options that were already out there. Just didn't really meet the needs of what we were looking for. So, let's see, some of the higher level protocols. So, IoTivity OCF support. This is something that came in as kind of one of our ecosystem types of projects. So it's not actually part of the Zephyr tree, but it's another project that links into Zephyr. So you can go look at, I'm not sure where it's located off the top of my head, but it is another project that, that does include support for Zephyr. Open OCD support was added. I think somebody asked about tools a little bit ago. We saw two new architecture ports get added in 1.7. So we saw RISC-V come in from a contributor from the community, which was pretty exciting. That was not something that came from one of the Platinum members of the project, and an Extensa port. So we are currently working on our 1.8 release. One of the big things that came in this release is that we transitioned over to GitHub. This may not sound like a big thing, it's just moving to Git repo, but there's a lot of continuous infrastructure or continuous integration infrastructure that came into play to get all that moved from what we had in Garrett that was hosted at the Linux Foundation to something that's a little bit more accessible to general developers. We found a lot of people came in and just were really confused by Garrett. They didn't quite understand it. It was great for maintainers, but we wanted to lower the barrier to entry and, you know, encourage more contributions. So we decided to move to GitHub. That is kind of maybe distracted us a little bit from adding new features, but I think in the long run, it's really going to help. Let's see, infrastructure improvements, tickless kernel, so ecosystem. We began working on supporting additional ecosystem tools, things like SegerRTT, things, you know, we're really starting to look at new ecosystem types of support. So tracing, debugging support through third-party tools, pulled in PyOCD, things like that. And then the last thing that we pulled in for 1.8 was the beginnings of memory protection. Most of these devices don't have MMUs, but many of them do have MPUs. And so we are exploring how we can support MPUs across multiple devices. It's kind of been an interesting exercise because not everybody has the same MPU. there's a stock ARM MPU, and then NXP, we have our own MPU, and so we've been trying to figure out how do we support both and some sort of common APIs. And it's only going to get a little bit more complicated as we look into other architectures that aren't ARM as well. And looking toward the future, so I have a pretty long list of things that we're looking at supporting in the future. One of the big ones that I think will come very soon here is improving our build and debug infrastructure. So many of the developers that work on this project have a background in Linux. And unfortunately, that's meant that some of our users that come from the Windows world, our build infrastructure is a little bit clunky at this point for Windows, and so we're really looking at improving that story in our future release. And so, you know, looking at, you know, can we use CMake or other kinds of tools to build Zephyr in a more Windows-friendly environment. Some of that work has started, but it didn't make it into the 1.8 release, and so that's why I have it in the future. Quite a list here. I think one thing I want to emphasize is there's a particular feature that you're looking for that's not on this list. That doesn't mean that we can't do it or we don't want to do it. Like I said, if it's something that you're willing to contribute and want to participate in, you know, let's start a conversation on the mail list or on IRC and talk about it.
What do you mean by stateless curl?
So our tosses often have a regular tick. In this case, it's quite often a millisecond tick. It'll wake up and check if it needs to reschedule a thread. And so when you're talking about low power devices, you can turn off that tick and say, I don't need to wake up for another certain, you know, certain amount of time.
I think I call that a time. No. And that 1.7 release looks very major. There are a lot of people involved.
You know, I'd say each release, more and more people get involved. That was when we really started seeing, like I said, you know, people from the community beginning to contribute. That RISC-V port was quite a bit of work.
Do you have any idea of what the code base was like for that release?
What the code base was like?
Yeah,
what do you mean?
Like when you had contributions to the build, I mean, it must have been a huge thing.
There were probably quite a few revisions that have went into that. We found, you know, some developers that, you know, have submitted patches to Linux and other open source projects, like have a little bit more familiarity about how to format their patches and how to break things down into smaller chunks. Some developers don't, and they require a little bit more, you know, handholding. I think that one, while it did take some time because it was a new architecture port, we don't see those every day. It certainly took some time, but as far as I know, it went pretty smoothly.
And can you describe the development environment?
The development environment? I think how.
Typical one.
So I'd say most typically people are developing on a Linux host machine, and I think that's probably the most well supported. We do have people developing on Macs, and I think we have some users that try to build on Windows, but I wouldn't say many of our active developers are using it at this time. So that's why, you know, looking to the future, we're trying to work on that a little bit. You know, the SDK, like I mentioned earlier, so any tools that you need to build Zephyr are all included in the SDK, and so you can download that. Unfortunately, the SDK only support builds for Linux right now, so if you do want to go build in Windows, you need to go grab, you know, an ARM tool chain that's been built for Windows and things like that. So it's a little bit more involved getting.
You include the ARM compilers and stuff in the tool chain.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we include the ARM compilers. We do have Kemu support for most of our architectures. That's actually how a lot of the higher level stacks have been developed. So the guys that are developing the networking stack aren't always working on hardware. If they don't have, you know, all the hardware boards available, they can do a lot of their work without having to touch hardware. So now, obviously, we need to go test things on hardware, but I think it's pretty cool that they can do this work.
Yeah, I saw that you use QEMU.
Yeah.
So that's nice. What is the debugging like?
What is the
in hardware? I know it'd be nice with QEMU.
Yeah.
I've actually got an ST micro hooked up or something.
Yeah, so quite a few of the devices use OpenOCD. ST, I think, is one of them. We have pretty limited support for OpenOCD on the NXP parts, and so that's why we pulled in PyOCD recently. We do support Segger, although that's not an open source tool chain or tools, so some people are a little uncomfortable with that, but it is there if you're okay with that. And that has the widest range of support. So we kind of have this problem of, you know, do we pick a closed debugger tool that supports all of our parts, or do we have something that's open source that only supports some of them? So we try to support, you know, all the different options that, you know, are available. Does that answer your question?
So I need to build an environment to see.
Yeah.
Kind of critical that we'll be able to single step and separate.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. In fact, the make file or the make build tool, as long as you're building on Linux, you can type make flash and it will flash the part. You can type make debug and it'll actually pull up a GDB server and attach a client to it. And so you're right there in GDB prompt and you can start debugging.
You had mentioned earlier about starting a discussion. We actually have a Slack team. Might be awesome to create a channel for NXP. Is that something you might be interested in?
Perhaps. I don't know. We haven't been communicating on Slack yet, but Yeah, I don't know. Most of the developers are commuting on IRC right now, so we have a pretty active IRC channel where, you know, if you ever need help or want to talk to a developer, there's quite a few developers on that on a daily basis. Yeah?
Is BLE Mesh looking promising to happen in 2017?
I know that there are developers working on it. I don't know the status of it at this point.
Like the standard was just defined.
Yeah, there was some holdup in getting the standard approved. I know that the, you know, companies that had access to it, you know, were able to start development, but until that got approved, they couldn't actually go release anything.
It's not officially approved yet.
What's that?
It's not officially approved yet.
Is it not? I thought it. No.
Might be a second revision.
Yes.
I noticed you have. You mentioned things like socket can, and you had on the previous slide IPC. So, is that the implication that you're actually going to run multiple applications under Zephyr on the same chip? Is it when you load code into the chip, are you loading the OS or are you loading an application for the OS?
Both together. So we compile and link them all together in a single binary.
Okay. So what is IPC doing?
That's why the configurations are important. You choose what you want to put together.
Right. But I can see you keeping the OS separate from the application, sort of like you do with Linux and all the other systems. But you mentioned IPC, which applies to independent applications communicating with each other.
There's some of that work that's coming on with running models that are coming into play, but that's future work that we don't have.
And there are some multi-core devices as well, like a heterogeneous kind of configuration where one of the Intel boards, our Arduino board actually has an x86 core and a Nordic or an ARC core, and there's a Nordic, or no?
I thought it was an Intel and an ARC actually.
I think there's another chip on that board as well. So there's actually three different architectures on there, and I think that ARC and the x86 communicate over some sort of protocol.
I probably missed the first part. What are the tool chains currently supported?
What are the tool chains?
Yeah.
GCC. And LLVM is in the works.
It's supported in some environments.
Okay. I haven't played with it, so I don't know the status of LLVM, but GCC.
The GCC is not the one like provided by Linaro, right?
So at this point, Intel is building the tool chains with the future tool chain release. We actually plan on pulling some of the pre-built tool chains. So ARM, for example, used the GCC ARM embedded.
Yeah.
And I think ARC also has a similar tool chain that they pre-built. And so a future SDK release, we're looking at just using those straight out of the box rather than building the tool chains ourselves.
Isn't GCC covered by copyleft license, whereas this is supposed to be Apache license?
The tool, it's a binary that comes out of this, is what's important, and another compiler is linked together with this code, right? It's a binary. I can go into much more detail of licensing than you really want
she
me to
can.
Right now.
Bottom line is I'm covered by Apache license and not a new license.
Correct.
GCC for them.
That's exactly
yeah, correct. Your runtime code is all Apache, and there are components that are BSD, but all permissively licensed.
And we have lawyers very much very carefully studying the fact that we're using the kconfig stuff, because that is GPL, because it's coming in from Linux. And we basically went through a lot of legal scrubbing before we launched this project with that, just to make sure we were going to be fine for people. And yes, we've got pretty covered.
So the ARM compiler doesn't actually modify GCC at all.
Well, the ARM compiler is being used to compile the Zephyr code, and it's the binary that comes out is what the license counts against, and what you link together in that code.
Right.
And you're not linking the compiler in the code; you're just using it to
generate
the code.
Not even the like the startup runtime or anything like that.
No, we've got bootloader and some other stories here.
Cool. Thank you.
That's the general nature of the beast. You can use the compiler to compile your own code, and your code is not automatically on GPL.
Correct.
Okay.
Right.
But if you branch the compiler, what do you
if you modify the compiler, yeah. But somebody's already done that. They embedded an ARM compiler or something you can use do you happen to have like a VM package together that has a complete environment so you can just download it to play with? I think that'd be a good idea.
When can you have that done, Dave?
That's a great idea.
Patch is welcome.
Yeah, like you said, there are, you know, we think there are a lot of benefits to, you know, joining the Zephyr project and, you know, adopting the Zephyr RTOS. You know, rolling your own can be expensive. You know, it might be fun as an engineer to build it. We all like to build things, but in the long term, it's really difficult to maintain it and be sustainable. We just talked about licenses. So we all know that Zephyr is permissively licensed. There are a number of corporate sponsorships to you know, give it a long-term base of commitment and longevity. So we have Intel, NXP, Synopsys, and then there are a number of other vendors that are participating through Linaro as well. You know, with the help of the Linux Foundation, you know, we have a long-standing reputation of open source investment. And community innovation and collaboration, you know, we can see development happening a lot faster than something you might do yourself or try to do in-house. You know, Zephyr's a really fast-moving project. We've seen a huge number of new features, new boards, new architectures, new SoCs all come in over the course of just a year. It's pretty awesome to see how much it's exploded since we got started a little bit over a year ago. So I think that kind of covers it for our presentation today. So thank you guys all for listening. Glad to be here and hope you guys are take a closer look yourselves, download the code, contribute. All right, now the fun part. We've got a quiz. I brought some boards to give away and some t-shirts. So these are all boards that support Zephyr, and so something that you can take home and play with. So, first question. Do we have anybody here that's contributed code to Zephyr already? All right. I had to try.
Can't believe we got for trying.
Had to try. I wanted to thank whoever had, you know, we did have somebody. Okay, second question. Who can name all the architectures that Zephyr supports?
ARM M controller. Codex M controller.
All the
architectures. ARC, PRC, x86.
Six. Oops, okay.
Yeah, ARM, x86,
ARC,
RISC, T-Silica,
and EOS2. That's all of them. We got a winner.
That was
good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. All right. Next question. Who can tell me what's the smallest code size code footprint that?
AK.
All right.
Who was first?
Who was first there?
The front. Okay.
Because
I
looked
at that one. On this
one. All right. Next question.
42.
How many unique authors did we have in our first year?
80?
207.
There we go.
Hey.
All right.
Things you remember.
I have a head for numbers for some stupid reason.
That's awesome. All right, next question. How many boards?
Oh,
57.
That's why I asked that question. I knew it was coming.
I knew it was coming.
Yeah.
Sweet. I
should
have more questions. I only have one left. I've got more stuff. All right, this is an easy one. Where do you contribute code?
GitHub.
I'll hold it.
Big blue t-shirt.
Thank you.
There was a tie with you.
We got two more t-shirts.
So. I'm out of my trivia question. Do you have any cake? Put you on the spot.
Sounds good.
Sure.
One
size fits all.